promises may become partakers of your heavenly treasure. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Amos. Alas, for those who are at ease in Zion, and for those who feel secure on Mount Samaria. Alas, for those who lie on beds of ivory and lounge on their couches, and eat lambs from the flock and calves from the stall, who sing idle songs to the sound of the harp, and like David, improvise on instruments of music, who drink wine from bowls and anoint themselves with the finest oils, but are not grieved over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore, they shall now be the first to go into exile, and the revelry of the loungers shall pass away. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, it is he alone who has immortality and dwells in an unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. As for those in the present age are rich, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of life that really is life. Hear what the Spirit is saying to God's people.
Thank you, God.
Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
the name of the living God, immortal, invisible, and wise. Amen. I don't know about you, but I've always wanted a Harry Potter invisibility cloak. Sometimes I joke that that's what this is. Being able to move about in the world stealthy and unnoticed would be convenient at times, don't you think? Today's gospel, however, confronts this fantasizing about that magical ability of mine. Some never have a choice about whether to be seen in a given space or to slip past others unnoticed. Indeed, some spend their whole lives without anyone in the world even acknowledging their existence. The life and death stakes in Jesus' parable ring just as true in our world, where the dignity of people living in poverty can all too often be completely undetected. Lazarus and his starving body covered in sores didn't ask to be invisible to everyone but the dogs. And yet, there at the city gate, he lived, longing for food, for love, languishing, invisible to the wider community. All while the man of means in the story dressed and dined like royalty. As Jesus' stories so often do, this parable challenges us to examine interpersonal investments we make or don't because of who we see belonging to our community. I've heard many of you describe beautiful experiences of finding yourself noticed and embraced with loving welcome as you were exploring whether to make St. Paul's your spiritual home. Such a warm, welcoming embrace is something God wants every human being to know. And no strings attached belonging is pretty rare in our world. Sacred connections take resources to create, even when God is the one who orchestrates endless possibilities. We talk about this kind of holy connection in the church using the term the beloved community, put some understanding around that divine reality that becomes not just possible, but sustainable, as the gifts of every person are seen and valued. Now, in the world of the story, it's not until Lazarus and the rich man arrive to the eternal realms that we get a peek at this evaluating move of what are the gifts of each of these characters? Resources that brought ease and pleasure to the man of means in his earthly life no longer put him squarely at the center of influence, networked with family and friends. His eternal isolation is tied quite clearly to the chasm created by self-centered, consumer-driven earthly habits. Lazarus, on the other hand, was severely limited in his earthly life, cut off from communal resources that might otherwise have supported his well-being. And that disastrous reality caused great suffering for Lazarus. In heaven, though, Lazarus is welcomed into the bosom of Abraham, as the scriptures in the old language say it, a place of protection and provision among the ancestors, right there at the heart of God's family circle. Lazarus never knew the lack of luxury, but he's welcomed home as if onto that doting knee of a dear grandparent, lavished with everything he could ever need. Ironically, we hear Father Abraham, who you might recall in the Old Testament, once bargained with God on behalf of a city on its way to destruction, begging God, well, what if there's only 20? Will you save them then? How about 10? Will you do it for 10? What if there's only 5, God? Will you please, please spare the city for those 5 faithful ones? And yet today, we see Father Abraham set up as patriarch who was blessed by God to be a blessing, denying the thirsty one a life-saving drink? Isn't God the giver of good gifts? Indeed, God bestows on each of us that sacred gift of free will, along with the privilege to choose to say yes or no to this divine invitation to the people of blessing. The parable's water imagery has been awash in my mind as I've been praying to people affected recently by Hurricane Fiona, especially residents of Puerto Rico, our very own American friends and neighbors who frequently have been left to struggle without essential resources like electricity and water in the aftermath of shattering natural disasters. God's heart breaks when human suffering is compounded by tragedy. Does our communal heart weep with them? Does it move us to compassionate action? God's reign, Scripture tells us, is one that reveals the first will be last, and the last will be first. The thirsty will be sated, and the satisfied will be taught to thirst for God's justice and joy. What might this paradox mean for us in this season? For God surely does not intend that any should suffer, but rather that all might awaken more fully to the comprehensive nature of Jesus' good news. His love never stops reaching out to save us. God's decentering of our small s selves and recentering of our lives in Christ always leads us back, step by step, to the way, the truth, and that beloved community we are intended to know together, held by the grace of God, manifest through incarnate love. Love invites us to see what is yet invisible and to be set free to participate in God's dream for the world. Today's parable shows us pretty clearly that our personal and communal choices have eternal implications. Love is restless to live in us and shine through us, freeing us to work for creation's flourishing, for the planet, its creatures, and its peoples. We know this not just through divine revelation, but in those many powerful tales of reversal that long have captivated human imagination, spellbinding our hearts as we awaken to our need to be transformed. We can see that same prophetic edge springing to life in the stories of the Brothers Grimm. And C.S. Lewis wrote a whole novel about the afterlife called The Great Divorce that's well worth a read. And yes, who could forget Charles Dickens' classic, A Christmas Carol, that has been cherished from generation to generation. In this season, as we pray about those new beginnings that God is inviting us to dream about and to lean into, we carry with us these stories of provocation and possibility. They open our hearts to God's urgent priorities that dare us not to waste time in cultivating those fruits of the Spirit like generosity, faithfulness, and goodness. May we pray for God to align our habits with our aspirations to be people of courage and creativity, a beloved community empowered to live and love boldly because God first knew, loved, and welcomed us. May we never treat one another as invisible or unwelcome. And may we respect the diverse vulnerabilities and gifts we each bring longing to be nurtured, seen, and celebrated, not only now, but in the time to come. Amen.
Give them courage and hope in their troubles and bring them the joy of your salvation. Larry Margolis, Stephanie Medina, Darren Goss, John Miller, George Simon, Riley Volpi, people of Ukraine, the people of Russia, people of Afghanistan, people of Mexico, and the people of Puerto Rico. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, let us say our prayer for mission together. Gracious and loving God, help us to stay to understand and celebrate your dream for the world, to be transformed in Jesus' love, and to use our gifts to make the difference of others. Amen.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry.
Fall fellowship meals, and it is a very busy fall. We have rummage. We have Reverend Sarah's installation that is going to be so exciting. Concerts and evensong. But I do want to encourage you to see if you can find time to spend in fellowship with fellow St. Paul's people and with Reverend Sarah. The dates are October 9th, October 22nd, and 23rd, and we have two hosts. Thank you so much for each of these days. Now, an apology. Somehow, the link for Sign Up Genius that went out in the e-blast this week, something's wrong with it. Haven't figured out what is wrong with it yet, but we will get this fixed, and we apologize. In the meantime, though, I will be outside, along with maybe Brian, at coffee hour, and you can sign up the old-fashioned way with pens and pencils, Ben. Thank you, Serena, who's been helping to coordinate this, and is one of our very gracious hosts. You can also just email Brian or me, and we will make this happen for you. So we hope very much to see everyone there. Thank you.
Thanks, Anne. Also, hold in your prayers those who will be part of our diocesan confirmation this evening at 6 o'clock at Grace Cathedral. And if you happen to find yourself in the city and want to be part of standing alongside them in support of this step that they are taking in public witness, we heard in that lesson from Timothy, this proclamation, the importance of these moments in our life together. And it's not just the people who are saying the thing, it's the people who bear witness, and that's an important role that the community has to nurture and support all who are growing with their questions and their wrestling and their moments of embracing this faith that is a dynamic, ever-evolving thing for each and every one of us, our whole lives long. So pray for our confirmants and come if you are able. It will be a joyful time. So let us walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us in offering and sacrifice for the whole world.
Thank you.
and every living thing. You made us in your image and taught us to walk in your ways, but we rebelled against you and wandered far away. And yet, as a mother cares for her children, you would not forgive us. Time and again, you called us to live in the fullness of your love. And so, this day, we join the saints and angels in the chorus of praise that rings through eternity, lifting our voices to magnify you as we sing.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
God for the people of God. Whoever you are, wherever you are on your journey, you are welcome at God's table.
Thank you. Lord.